Okay, so today we're going to move on to the first of the real lectures about the geosphere, and we're going to remind you about plate tectonics. And this is one of the things that we haven't really, we always think that we know everything about the Earth, and we've always known everything about the Earth. But remember that plate tectonics was something that we've come up with surprisingly recently. If you go back and ask your grandparents, then most likely they weren't being taught about this stuff at school because we didn't necessarily know about it yet. So it's been one of those really amazing sort of theories that has really helped us get a much better sense of actually how the world operates. So, first of all, how was quiz one? So the people at the front say horrible. Okay, well, it's sort of designed that way a little bit because I want you to realize what you get and what you don't. And that's really the point of that quiz. If you can tackle the quizzes and do fine, you will be absolutely okay in exams. And that's the point. I don't want you to find out that you can't do something in exams. So well done for those of you who did well in the quiz. If you didn't do as well as you hoped in the quiz, so perhaps if you got 10 or less, then I would seriously contemplate coming to see me in office hours. I have office hours immediately after lecture today, and then tomorrow and Wednesday as well, and the Thursday as well, I think. So please do come see me, because it's important that you grasp what we've been learning before we move on too far onto other stuff. And I'm always very happy to go over the quiz questions, okay? Most of the quiz questions have sort of 80, 90% success rate, so I'm not gonna go through them individually now, but your TA will be happy to do that in discussion time as well. If you access the quiz, if you give me half an hour to make it back to my office after lecture, but if you go into quiz again and look at your submissions, you will be able to see which answers you got right and which ones you got wrong. Okay, so I do really encourage you to do that. Every year people up to the final say, oh, I don't know which ones I got right or wrong. You can always find that out after the quiz closes. Okay? So, extra credit opportunities. So for those of you who didn't do so well and are already thinking about, uh-oh, how am I gonna claim some of these points back? This is meant to be a creative, fun way of using what you're learning in class. So this is a little photo competition, okay? It's not really a competition. But by midnight each Sunday, you can upload one photo with a full caption to the Dropbox that I'll set up. And that sort of photo and the caption has to relate to what we've been learning that week. And I want to stress the caption, because last time we just got pictures, and you won't get points if you just upload a picture and like two words. I want a full caption explaining how it relates. And last year I had some really amazing sort of photos. I had sort of plate tectonics and plates on people's sort of sideboards and sort of different geological sequences in terms of sushi plates and things like that. So we had some really fun photos. So be creative and think about this stuff. So each photo will receive one or two extra credit points. You should have taken the photo yourself or be in it. If you've downloaded a photo off the internet and we find you've done that, you won't be able to earn any extra credit in any assignment for this class, okay? So please don't abuse the system. Does anyone have questions about this? No? Okay, great. So let's launch straight in. So this is a review of what we did last week. But remember, when we talked about terrestrial planets, which are those rocky planets that are closest to the sun, and we have Mercury, Venus, Earth, and Mars, then we said that as they form, as they collide, energy is produced, and that energy goes into sort of melting the interior of these rocky bodies. And when those interiors are molten, what can happen is that the heavier stuff, the denser material, sinks into the center, and the lighter stuff, getting tangled up, the lighter stuff rises to the top. And so what we end up with, because of this differentiation process, is different components of the Earth. We end up with a structure to the Earth. We end up with different layers. Okay? And those layers are the core, and we can split the core into two types. There's the solid inner core, and then there's the liquid outer core. And we'll come back to talk about that a lot today, because we're going to talk about magnetic fields. And then we have the mantle. And then we have the crust. And this all sounds probably fairly familiar. And these are the different layers that we define based on their composition. So if you look at the top half of that diagram, you can see that those layers are defined for us. And the crust in particular, which is what we live on, which is what we're most familiar with, is really, really, really thin. If you took an apple or something like that, the layer of the crust is about the same as that peel. It's a really thin outer layer compared to the rest. But it's very dynamic, and that's what we're going to look at today. Okay. But we can also separate the different layers of the Earth into different layers based on their strength. So the first three, the crust, the mantle, the core, they're based on compositional differences. So the core is made of mostly iron and nickel and perhaps some sulfur. The mantle is more rocky, and then the crust has a specific composition as well, which we'll get onto. But then we also have these different strength layers. And so on the outside, we have the lithosphere. And the lithosphere is rigid and brittle, and it is composed of both that crust, but also the very top of the mantle. So that lithosphere is thicker than the crust. It also contains the upper part of the mantle. And then we have something called the asthenosphere, which is another funny word, but that's a layer immediately under the lithosphere, and that is hot and weak and plastic. And we'll come back to that word in a second. And then the mesosphere is what's underneath all that. And we're not going to talk about the mesosphere at all, but we will use the words lithosphere and asthenosphere today when we talk about plate tectonics. It's important for those reasons. And I have my first iClicker question of the day. Always seems a surprise to everyone. Is the mantle solid or liquid? More seconds for the last few. Okay, wow, a lot of people today. So let's see. So 63% of people said solid, but 35% of people said liquid. Okay, and this isn't your fault. So the 63% are correct. Yes. But 35% of you, it's not your fault, and I'll tell you why. It's because of the silly way that we draw diagrams in scientific textbooks a lot. Because what color is usually the mantle in these diagrams? It's orange. And orange seems to us to be like lava and magma and things like that. We think of it as liquid, okay? But I have a lump of sort of what we call blue tack in the UK, we stick posters up with, but you might call it plasticine or modeling clay or something like that. Is this solid or liquid? Solid. It's solid. But look, if it's warm enough, it will flow and break. But it will flow as well, okay? And that's really the idea behind the lithosphere and the asthenosphere. So what happens is that that lithosphere will break, like that did there. I put too much force on it, it was too cold, and it broke. It's brittle. The asthenosphere underneath that lithosphere is still solid, but it will deform. It will bend and it will flow when we put pressure on it. Does that make sense? So that asthenosphere underneath is really very nice and hot, and so it will flow, and so it will move around. That doesn't necessarily mean it's liquid, though. Okay, so that's sort of the structure of the deep interior of the Earth. But we live on the surface, and we want to understand, if we look at a map of the Earth, there are a number of different patterns and features that we'd like to be able to explain. So first off, what is the two different types of crust that we have? What are the two biggest distinctions when you see that? Ocean and continents. Okay, so why are the oceans where they are? Why are the continents where they are? Why do we have mountain ranges where they are? Now that we know what the ocean floor looks like, why do we have that mountain range running all the way around? Why do volcanoes and earthquakes occur in similar places and in certain bands around the Earth? Why do we get different types of rock in specific places? These were the things that geologists really struggled to explain without the idea of plate tectonics. Everyone would study their little thing in isolation, and we had no theory that could bring everything together and describe the Earth as a whole. And so that's the amazing thing about plate tectonics. We'll look at all of these things. So first of all, I want you to introduce you to a very old idea. So it's really, as soon as we started creating maps, people went, ooh, it looks like those continents might have once fitted together. And so early on, so even in 1596, those really early maps, which were surprisingly good for how they were made, say, oh, well, it looks like the Americas were torn apart from Europe and Africa, and it all got very biblical, okay? And we didn't really know how that could happen. And then as our maps got better and better, then people again came back to this idea that those coastlines really look like they fit remarkably well. Is it a coincidence? And so we have our hero for the day, who's good old Alfred Wegener. And early on in the 1900s, so in 1914, he proposed this idea of continental drift. He proposed this idea that the continents were once all clustered together and that they could move around. Okay, so if you were Alfred Wegener and you wanted to prove that this was the case, sorry, do you have a question? Yeah. He is the same guy that named it Pangaea, absolutely. Good knowledge at the front. You'd be good at pub quizzes. So Pangaea, which means all land, okay? And so, yeah, he says that this sort of idea of a supercontinent, all the different continents today were clustered together. And so what was his evidence? What do you think he looked for to try and say that this was the case? Can anyone think of anything? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. You could look at matching fossils. So the idea is that if you find one type of animal on all the continents, that maybe they were linked together once. Absolutely. And not just animals, but plants as well. Anything else? Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. Matching sediments and rocks. You can imagine that the rocks should match up on either side of the continents if they were once together. Anything else? You've got the big ones. Okay. So, firstly, it was that the continental shorelines seemed to fit together. Great. Okay, so that was our first piece of evidence. And then what he did was he went and he looked for some of these other pieces of evidence, and he did find that you could match fossils on all of these different continents. And then he also found that you could find matching rocks and also rock structures. So mountain ranges that would actually once have linked together and that might have been broken apart. And not only fossils, the fact that they existed by themselves, but they also indicated that we had different bands of climate zones and that they could have made sense in terms of how we think about the world and the different climate zones if the continents were in different positions. And it was difficult to reconcile that if the continents were in their position today. So one example he used was a very distinctive type of sediment left behind by big glaciers and ice sheets. And he found that you could find little patches of this all over, but say up in India today. And that is really difficult to explain if the continents are in the same position. But he had some problems. So he, first of all, the coastlines are constantly being eroded and things like that. How good a fit should we really be able to expect? Is it just a giant coincidence that these things seem to fit together? The second one, well, we all know that even if, say, New Zealand is really separated from Australia today, then we know that plants can still get there because they could be carried by birds or they could be carried by the wind. And fossil animals as well, they can island hop, perhaps when sea level is lower, or they could raft, perhaps not huge distances, but they could theoretically travel from different places. And so these were the arguments that were sort of given to him. And the main problem with all of this is that how on earth do you take something the size of a continent and have it sailing happily across the ocean crust? How on earth do you get these things to move? They're enormous. So how on earth do you do that? And that was his problem. He had this wonderful hypothesis about continental drift. But he couldn't propose a mechanism. There was no mechanism that he could use. And I can hear frantic typing, so I'm going to pause for a second while people catch up. And remember, you can get these notes after lecture as well. Okay. So, as a treat for the extra hard quiz, we're going to have the Alfred Wegener tribute song because it's too good not to share with everyone. Who's heard this before? No one? You're in for a treat. Okay. It's by the Amoeba people who do amazingly hilarious songs. There you go. So with some amazing dad dancing in there. And I challenge you ever to forget about Alfred Wegener now. And I've had that going around in my head all weekend. So now it's your turn. Okay. So, and it really is quite a sad story because he came up with this idea. He found a lot of the evidence. And then it's true. He was taking supplies to an expedition on Greenland. And he was actually being quite a hero. That they were stuck up and there was a big storm coming in. And they were going to be there over the winter. And he said, we can't leave these people without supplies. So a lot of his expedition turned back. But he and another guy sort of fought on and got the supplies across. But then sadly, on the way back, they got caught in a blizzard. And he died. And so if he'd lived, he could have come to see the sort of fruition of all his work. That actually, he was right. That once we could sort of, once we learned a little bit more, the technology that came just after that time allowed us to find evidence that really supported this idea and provided a mechanism. So, what is some of that new evidence and how did we find it? Well, a lot of that new evidence actually comes from Earth's magnetic field and the record that it leaves behind. So here's our Earth, And remember that we talked last week that it's actually the liquid outer core, the movement of the iron in that outer core that generates our magnetic field. And the movement of that iron is caused by the rotation of the Earth. So we have our axis of rotation that goes through our north sort of geographic and south geographic poles. And it really is that sort of spinning of the Earth that creates movement, just like that, those coils that you see in the outer core. And that movement of the iron generates a magnetic field. And because those coils, that movement is aligned with our north and south geographic poles, then we get a north and south magnetic pole as well. We can treat the Earth's magnetic field just like a dipole magnet, just like a standard magnet that you messed around with at school, with a north and a south pole. And they have field lines. So if you ever did that experiment where you had a bit of paper and a magnet underneath, and you sprinkle iron filings on the top, and they align themselves in the patterns that you see there, in those sort of those rings that come out of one pole and into another. So that's our magnetic field. And this is a brief aside, but I think it's really cool. So don't worry about taking frantic notes. But I think when we talked about Earth's habitability, we said that Earth had a magnetic field, and that really helped us retain our atmosphere, because that magnetic field shields us from the solar wind. So this stream of really energetic particles coming out from the sun that otherwise would collide with our atmosphere and also with us, which wouldn't be a good thing. And so we have our magnetic field, and it shields us from that. And it's almost like a boat going through water. It gets stretched out, sort of downstream of the Earth. And you can see that where those field lines come in at the north and the south pole, that's where those high energy particles can get closer to the atmosphere. And what do they result in? The auroras. That's why we have northern lights. So we also have southern lights, but no one's on Antarctica to see it often. It's because that's those high energy particles interacting with gases in the very upper part of our atmosphere. And that's because those field lines are going in at the north and the south pole, and so those particles can come in a little bit, whereas we don't get those around the equator. So an aside, but I think it's pretty cool. Okay. So we have a magnetic field, and the reason that we can use the magnetic field to investigate the past Earth's history is because rocks can lock in a record of the magnetic field at the time that they cooled down. So in particular, we're thinking about volcanic rocks. So rocks that start off very hot and cool down relatively quickly, like on the side of a volcano. And what happens is that above maybe 580 degrees Celsius or so, that there's enough thermal energy, there's enough heat energy, that the electrons around the atoms orientate just randomly. They just sort of move around all the time, and so they don't record the magnetic field. But as you cool that rock down, so below that 580 degrees Celsius or so, then there's less energy. Those electrons aren't moving around as much, and so they tend to get locked into position. And the position that they tend to lock into aligns itself with Earth's magnetic field. And as long as that rock, when we go and find it today, hasn't moved around, hasn't eroded and rolled into a different position, then we can look at the signature, we can look at the magnetism of that rock, and we can know what the magnetic field was like in the past. Which is really very cool. Does that make sense to everyone? So when it's too hot, there's no magnetization of the rock, but once it cools down, that rock locks in the position of the magnetic field at that time. So not today's, at the time it cooled. And what we can find is that just like a compass, so hopefully everyone's used a compass, that if you hold it like that, then you can work out which way north is, right? Okay, and you can use rocks in the same way. You can use the orientation of them to say, oh well, said that north was that direction 200 million years ago, or something like that. But there's something else that we can use, and it's called the inclination. So instead of taking your compass and sort of looking at it in the horizontal plane, what happens if we have something that actually moves in the vertical instead? Because do you remember we said, look at those field lines. So they sort of come out of one pole and then they come into the other. And what that means is that down by the South Pole and the North Pole, those lines are sort of pointing straight into the Earth. And so when that rock cools, that's the way that its magnetism will lock in as well, be pointing really steeply down. If we look near the equator, then those field lines are more or less sort of straight on, parallel to the Earth's surface. And so that's what the rock will also record. It'll record something that's more parallel rather than pointing straight down, which is really neat, because what that does is it doesn't just tell us the direction of the pole in the past, but it tells you what latitude you're at, whether you are closer to the equator or whether you are closer to the pole, which is really cool. Okay, so that's orientation and inclination. And my really evil iClicker question of the day, this is to really challenge you, is here is a lovely sequence of rocks, and we've measured the magnetism in those different rocks. So the white circle shows you the orientation. So just like a normal compass would show you which direction north is in. But then the funny black sort of tilty thing, that's the inclination, which remember tells you what latitude you're at. So moving from 200, which stands for 200 million years, to today, which is zero at the top, are we moving, is this location moving closer to the pole or further away? Talk amongst your friends. Okay, so a few extra seconds for the last few votes. I love seeing everyone do this. This makes me feel positive. Okay, let's see. This is one of those good examples when I go, okay, let's have a chat and then we can re-vote. Okay, so at 200 million years, is it tilting much more vertically or horizontally? Vertically. Where is it likely to point vertically? Close to the pole or close to the equator? Closer to the pole, right? What happens? What about at zero? Is it more horizontal or vertical? What does that mean about where it is? Do you want to vote again?
Yeah.
Hopefully half of you do. Okay, so let's have another quick vote. I'll give you a minute. Talk to the people around you. They might well have got it. Half of you do. Okay, has everyone had a chance to vote? Let's see if we do any better. Okay, let's see. Okay, I knew that this was going to be a really tricky question, so it's fine. Okay, so 200 million years, it's really vertical. And we saw, if we go back, that when it's really vertical, that means it must be close to the pole. Either the pole is close to it, or it's close to the pole. Yes? And what happens is that by the time we get to 0 million years, so to today, that angle is much more horizontal than vertical. And what that means is, if we look at our map, that means it must be much more like near the equator. It's much more horizontal than pointing straight down. So what that means is, if we were close to the pole to begin with, and we're now closer to the equator, we're moving further away from the pole. Yes? No? Maybe? Yep. So it's more tilted at 200 and it's less tilted. So we're moving from close to the pole further away. Anyway. Okay, so that was a bit of a challenge. So if you still don't get it, then perhaps chat to your colleagues after class. But we're going to move on now. Because this is one of the ways that we... This is one of the ways that we produce evidence that sort of the plates must have moved. Because if we go back and we look at that whole sequence of rocks, then we would look and see that it would look like the pole had been moving around. So in that one place, it would look like the pole has been shifting. But the problem is if we then go and do that on a different continent, and we reconstruct where the pole must have been, then they look different. And so we can't have two poles wandering in different directions. So the answer is, the reason it's called apparent polar wander is because it's not the pole that's moving. The pole is staying in the same place at this point, or close enough. What's actually moving are the continents are moving relative to each other. So what we would do in this case is we would take the red line that we'd reconstructed from North America and the black line from Europe, and we'd move the continents so that those paths lie on top of each other for that particular time interval. And so that's how we get a history for how the continents have moved. So the pole isn't moving, the continents are. And this was sort of the first big piece of evidence that Wegener was right. And I know that you've probably seen this before, but I want to show you what the continents have done. Uh-oh. So there's very calming music with this, which we don't need to listen to necessarily. So you can see that this was the time where all of those continents were joined together, but Pangaea sort of time. And then through time, you can see there's Pangaea, all land. And then we start breaking that big supercontinent up into smaller continents that look more similar to what we see today. Keep an eye on India. There it goes. And that's our Himalayas. Okay, so now keep an eye on where we are, because funny things are going to happen to where we are. Okay? So this is what's going to happen in the future, and we forget that, yes, we've seen changes in the past, but this isn't a process that has stopped. We're going to continue to see changes. And so if you come back in another couple of hundred of million years, Antarctica disappears off the pole, you're right, and we start building up another supercontinent again. And it's one of those things that keeps happening. We break a supercontinent apart, and the continents drift apart for a while, and then they come back together again. So this is our best idea of what might happen in the future. Okay. So the second piece of evidence, or collection of evidence, that led us to come up with the theory of plate tectonics is to do with the ocean floor. So remember, poor old Alfred Wegener was trying to come up with his theory at a time when our maps just had the continents and then blank areas of ocean. Whereas today, we have a much better idea because of the advances in technology of what the ocean floor looks like. On his map, the areas would just be blue. They had no idea what the bottom of the ocean would look like. Because how do you think before we have sort of more modern technology, how do you think they measure the depth of the ocean? You drop something off the side, attached to a long bit of rope, and it sinks all the way to the bottom, and you measure how long that is, and you pull it up again. That's not a particularly realistic way of mapping the whole world's ocean floor, okay? So we didn't have that good an idea. We also didn't necessarily know what it was made of. And so we have sonar. And this was something that happened because we had some world wars. And what did we use in World War II that might mean that we want to know what the bottom of the ocean looked like? Submarines, absolutely. And so there was this effort put into actually looking at what the bottom of the ocean floor might look like. And so sonar, which is basically just sound waves, are blasted from the bottom of your boat or your receiver, and then it goes to the bottom, and then it bounces back up to the top again, and you time the, I thought there was a question. You time the amount of time it takes to go from the boat to the floor and back. You divide it by two, and you get the depth. And then we also found out from doing that sort of survey that the deepest parts of the oceans weren't actually in the middle, they were towards the edges. And we also have this big mountain range with the volcanoes associated with it that runs through all of the ocean basins of the world. And then we went and we wanted to investigate further and we started deep sea drilling. So we could find the technology to go down and sort of take cores from deep in the ocean. And we found that actually the ocean crust was warmest close to those big mountain ranges and coldest close to the land. And also the thickness of sediment increased towards the land. And so if you think, well, partly that's just because you're close to the land, but also if you think that there's a constant rain of material, then you would expect if things have been around for longer, they'll have a thicker thickness of sediment. And so this was the idea that was proposed, this Harry Hess in 1960s. If I could have been a geologist any time, the 60s would have been the time to do it. It was such a really amazing time because all of these new ideas were coming out. And he proposed the seafloor spreading hypothesis. And this is starting to look very familiar in terms of plate tectonics, that we have rising magma, and we have this mid-ocean ridge above that rising magma where new ocean crust is being created. And that new ocean crust sort of constantly spreads apart and new crust is being created in the middle. And then because we can't keep on creating ocean crust forever because the Earth is the same size, then we have to be destroying it somewhere. And the place where we destroy it are these big trenches, those really deep parts close to the continent. Okay, so let's look a little bit more carefully. So we're going to come back to paleomagnetism. So the word paleo just means past. It's just us sounding fancy. So this is part two. So before we found that rocks could record the position of the poles and the latitude that they are at, and so we could reconstruct the movement of continents. But that was assuming that the pole doesn't move. And actually, what we found is that when we look at that sort of paleo record, it reversed completely. So where our current North Pole is, a few million years ago, we had a South Pole. And the North Pole would have been in the Antarctic. Okay? So the magnetic poles will every now and again switch. And we don't necessarily have that clear an idea of the mechanism of that. It's one of the really fascinating areas of research. Because we've been in sort of the phase that we're in for quite a long time now, and people are asking, well, what will happen if we start going through a reversal? How will this affect us today? So there's an interesting article there written by one of my undergrad lecturers, if people want to see that. But you can see that between reversals, we have nice, orderly magnetic field. We have a north pole and a south pole, more or less, and these field lines. During a reversal, it all goes nuts. It all goes really crazy, and we don't have just sort of one, sort of what we call a dipole anymore. We might have a quadrupole, so we actually have two norths and two souths, or even an octopole and four norths and four souths. It's not as orderly anymore. And so things like our compasses, definitely, you wouldn't be able to navigate particularly well, and people wonder about things like the way the animals migrate. But this doesn't happen overnight, okay? It happens over sort of maybe a few hundred years, if not longer, and so it's not something we need to worry about in the next week or so. But anyway, they've switched places. And what we can do is that we can look at those ridges, that mountain range that runs through the middle of our oceans. We call those mid-ocean ridges. And this is where new crust is constantly being created and then split apart so that new crust can be created in the middle again. And again, once we started mapping the magnetic features of the seafloor, again related to submarine research, we started noticing that we got these funny stripes in the seafloor. So we had almost like a barcode. We had sort of patterns where the rocks were magnetized in the normal north-south direction, and then times when it was reversed. And it's to do with that reversal of the pole. And so what we can do is that if we can look, say, we know that today we have our north magnetic pole at the north geographic pole, but say maybe 750,000 years ago, we know that that reversed. And we can look on the sea floor and we can see what distance away from the ridge that reversal happens in the seafloor, and we can get an idea of how quickly those ridges spread apart. So we get these symmetrical patterns on either side, and there's a little video there if you aren't familiar with this idea, and the textbook has a good idea of this too. So if we look at, say, the Atlantic, which has a really wonderful mid-ocean ridge running up through it in black there, you can see that we have older and older crusts, so those numbers, so 81, 135, 155, they represent millions of years, and those are periods of time when the field switched. We switched north and south, and so we know what time that was in terms of the sea floor. And so my question for you is, so North America and Europe are about 5,000 kilometers apart, and they've been spreading apart, if we look back at our map, for maybe 200, upper limit, but it makes the maths easy, 200 million years. So what rate of spreading is that? So cancel your zeros and see if you can work it out. Few more seconds. Okay, so let's see how your mental math is today. Ooh, very good, very good. Okay, so 25 kilometers per million year. And that doesn't really tell us anything, because it's difficult for us to relate to time spans that long and distances. So how about 2.5 centimeters per year? The rule of thumb, and I don't use that to be funny, but it's about as fast as your fingernails grow. So if you didn't cut your fingernails for a year, it would be pretty disgusting, but that's how far the plates are spreading apart each year. That's how fast they're moving, okay? And that's not trivial, really. If you think about how sort of long geological time is, that's not trivial. Okay. So, do you remember I said that the idea with the seafloor spreading hypothesis is that we have these areas where that sort of heavy, that dense, cold sort of ocean plate actually starts sliding back down, because we can't keep expanding the Earth's surface. That's not how it works. So if we're creating new crust, we have to be destroying old ocean crust somewhere. And this is what happens, and we call this a subduction zone, where that ocean plate subducts, goes back down into the mantle, okay? And one of the main reasons that we are pretty certain that this can happen is that if we look at earthquakes, so we now have an amazing network of seismometers that measure earthquakes around the world, and that allows us to pinpoint where they are, but also how deep they are. And so what we can see is that we look, so you can see the trench up there at the top, which is where those two plates actually meet, and they sort of dip down. But then you can see that those circles mark the position of earthquakes. And they really nicely sort of mark out for us where that ocean sort of plate is sinking down, the sort of the angle at which it goes down. And so those are what we call Benioff zones, these areas of really deep earthquakes that sort of progressively get deeper as you move away from a trench, and it shows where the ocean plate is going. Okay. So all of these bits of evidence, plus some others that we don't have time to go into, allowed us to create this theory. Remember, a theory is something we're really pretty certain about, that the Earth's lithosphere, the outer rigid part of its shell, is broken into a dozen or so rigid plates, and those plates move relative to each other on top of that asthenosphere. And remember, that asthenosphere is the hotter part, which can flow. It's not molten, but it can flow. Okay? And how do we actually define those different boundaries? Well, I mentioned before that one of the things that plate tectonics can explain is the position of, or the location of those earthquakes, the location of those volcanoes. And so if we look here, you can see that all of those different colored dots are earthquakes. And in particular, they're color-coded. So the blue ones are shallow, so they're less than 60 kilometers deep. And then we have green ones that are slightly deeper, and then red ones that are just sort of really huge in general. And you can see that we get a pattern. We get those nice shallow earthquakes at faults like ours and along those mid-ocean ridges. But where we get these subduction zones, and we're going to come back to this on Wednesday, so around the Pacific Ring of Fire, for example, we have these much deeper earthquakes. And here's a much nicer map of that, which shows these amazing earthquake sort of patterns, and you can really trace out the boundaries. Okay. We also get, okay, shh, not quite time, I've got two more minutes. So we also see patterns in volcanic activity associated with these active areas of plates colliding and splitting apart. And we can see different types of volcanic activity associated with different types of boundary. And we're going to come back to this when we talk about volcanic rocks and how we can use these differences to look at different places. Okay, we'll do the rest of this on Wednesday.